Now that we know what the purpose of the cache is and how big approximately it needs to be, let's look at how it is organized internally. The questions we need to ask ourselves is, how do we determine if we have a hit or miss? So we need to know what data do we have in the cache, and then when the processor gives us an address, we need to determine whether that data is or is not in the cache, and we need to do that very quickly. And the other important question is, how do we determine what to kick out from the cache once we are out of room in it and we need to put more stuff in it because we are just having a cache miss? So for the first question of how do we know whether we have a hit or a miss, we want something that is very fast. That means it needs to be a table of some sort that we can quickly index with some bits of the address, and it tells us what we have in the cache, and if we do have what we are looking for, then it gives us the data. So conceptually, the cache is a table which we index with some bits that we take from the address of the data. So some stuff here needs to tell us whether we have a hit, and the rest of the stuff here is the data we want if we do have the hit. How much data we have in each cache entry is called the block size or the line size, because the entry in the cache is also called a line. And they tell us how many bytes are in each of these entries. If we have only 1 byte per entry, then every address will map to a different entry. If we have a block size of 1, that means the entry in the cache is only 1 byte, every single byte address will have a different entry. That creates several problems. One, usually the processor can issue accesses not only to a single byte, but also, for example, load word and store word will access a 4-byte location. So for a single access, now we would need to look up 4 different lines in the cache. That complicates and slows down the cache a lot, so we definitely don't want a block size to be this small. We want the block size to be at least as large as the largest single access that we can do in the cache, and hopefully slightly larger than that, just so that when we do a load word or store word, we find the data in the same cache block most of the time. The next thing that we want to consider when deciding the block size is spatial locality. If we miss in the cache on one axis, we will bring in an entire block worth of memory stuff into the cache. So if there is no spatial locality, we want to bring in just what we are currently accessing. But if there is any spatial locality, we want to bring more than what we are just accessing. So typically, block sizes of 32 to 128 bytes work well, both from the perspective of they're larger than a typical access, and also they capture much of the spatial locality that exists in programs. Now let's look at block sizes of something like 1 kilobyte. In that case, what happens is we fetch a lot of data from memory every time we have a miss, and if there is not enough locality, a lot of that data will not be used. So we are occupying space in our cache. Remember that the cache is only 16 to 64 of these kilobytes, so if we bring in a block like this, we're consuming a significant part of the overall space in the cache. And we're doing it probably with data that we won't use much. So it turns out that for level 1 caches at least, we don't want the block size to be too large. So block sizes of 32 to 128 kilobytes are a balance between getting use of spatial locality when we bring stuff in versus not being dependent too much on there being a lot of spatial locality, because some programs don't have that much of it.